And to the analysis of Shields and Brooks, that is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Gentlemen, welcome. So we're going to talk about Common Core in a minute, but Mark, I want to start with what everybody's been talking about today, and that is Kathleen Sebelius out as Secretary of Health and Human Services after the big brouhaha over healthcare reform. What's her legacy?
Well, first of all, let me just admit up front, Kathleen Sebelius has been a personal friend for 46 years. I've known her, so I like her. I have not talked to her about this, but part of her legacy, in a strange way, is a Washington story that nobody really talks about. And that is, Bob Gates did in his book, and that is, each succeeding White House brings more and more power to the White House. Cabinet officials become essentially figureheads to a great degree. I mean, state and defense, perhaps, obviously less than others. And everything is micromanaged from the White House. The idea that the health care plan, the biggest initiative of this administration, the most historic action, was not going to be managed by the White House, was just absolutely begs the imagination. It just couldn't be true. They were on it. They were in it up to their eyebrows. So when it went wrong, somebody had to take the hit, and that was Kathleen Sebelius, and she took it. She was Secretary of HHS. She stepped up manfully, to use a bad adverb. She took responsibility. She took accountability. She apologized. And if it works, because the rule is very simple. Anything that goes right, Judy, the president gets credit. Anything that goes wrong, it goes to a cabinet officer or other factors. If this works out, if health care does turn out the way its supporters and many Americans want it to, then all credit will go to President Obama. If it doesn't, then Kathleen will be blamed, fairly, unfairly, or maybe not by historians, but in the short run.
Will she get some of the credit, though, David, if this works out in the long, long run?
Well, I guess so. If it works out in the long, long run, I mean, if we remember Frances Perkins, who was instrumental in passing Social Security, and she gets credit for that. So I think if it works out in the long, long run, which I'm skeptical about, that she will get some credit about it. Mark's right. I haven't been thrilled with the way the president sort of offloaded blame during the whole webpage fiasco. I thought he publicly should not have done that. He should have said, taken it on himself, just as a management, as a leadership technique. I think it's fair to say a couple things. First, she was, with all the reputation that's gone on, and it's very negative about her around Washington, she was certainly not a dynamo at HHS. And sometimes to move an organization, you have to be just a dynamo. And it seems that she was not that. Nonetheless, it is also true that secretaries do not run their agencies, that the agencies run their agencies. And the secretaries can have only a limited effect on what's going on.
You mean the bureaucracy?
The bureaucracy, the career people are really running the thing. And it was always going to be hard to get government workers who are not Silicon Valley tech geeks to start up a pretty ambitious website. And so I'm a little less down on her than is the common currency right now in Washington.
But I would take exception with David in the sense that, I mean, I'm sure David talks to a lot of people. I think that Kathleen got high marks from the kind of cliques in the cabinet, right? I mean, in Washington. And the people whom I know and whose I respect and whose performance I respect were high on Kathleen. The people who worked for her were fiercely loyal and very committed and kind of emotional in support. She was twice elected as a Democratic governor in Kansas, the reddest of Republican states. And she's one of the five best governors in the country, according to Time magazine. So, I mean, she was a person of considerable accomplishment when she came here, and she was key to Barack Obama. I mean, without Barack Obama, when Hillary Clinton became the woman candidate in 2007, Kathleen Sebelius was one of the few major women office holders who endorsed Barack Obama.
Well, now they've named another woman, David, Sylvia Burwell, who's been running Office of Management and Budget, take her place. Does this allow the administration to get a fresh start with health care?
I don't think the changeover of the cabinet secretary is going to change anybody's opinion on what they think about the thing. It strikes me as an exceedingly good choice. Burwell overcame some early disadvantages. She went to Harvard, got a Rhodes Scholarship. But despite that background, she's managed to do okay in life. She worked through the Clinton years. She's worked through the Obama years. She does around town. I've only met her a few times, but she has a sterling reputation, both for intelligence, for policy knowledge, experience, but especially for management implementation skills. So she's... If you walked around the Obama White House looking for people with the top reputations, she certainly would be among them.
I think it was a good choice, and puts the Republicans on a who have made Obamacare and Affordable Care Act their centerpiece of what they stand for. I mean, that and that's it. They stand for opposition to it. It's going to be tough to oppose her, having voted 96-0 to confirm her as budget director just a year. That's right. Mm-hmm. So I think it's going to be tough to oppose her. But it's not a new start. But you don't have the face there any longer that you can blame and use as a target politically. You can't blame her.
Well, this week we also observe the anniversary of another big, big piece of legislation, David, the 1964 Civil Rights Act. The whole week we've heard a lot about it. How do you believe the Civil Rights Act has changed this country?
Well, it's one of the great pieces of legislation of the 20th century, aside from the legal effect it had on how we enforce laws. And it sent a marker that discrimination of all sorts was just not going to be tolerated. And, of course, it's been an imperfect journey along that route. But the intellectual shift happened with that law, and that the people who were sort of defending any sort of discrimination or were motivated by any sort of unfairness were on the defensive. And I think it accelerated the increasing fairness of society. The one point I've said about all the coverage of it seems to me a little political heavy, a little LBJ heavy. If you looked at some of the momentum up to law, to me the crucial was a crucial event was the March on Washington. And it's worth remembering that when Baird Rustin and Philip Randolph really first initiated the idea from that march, there was intense opposition from the establishment civil rights groups. And it was seen as a bold move. It was only after Birmingham that you got some momentum behind that thing. And it's an emphasis that to pass major legislation like that, it really helps to have a gigantic social movement first. And it's very hard to do that without the social movement first.
Out in the country.
Yeah, no, and the March on Washington, just if you're going to pass no credit, Walter Reuther, the United Auto Workers, was the organizer, architect, engineer, and producer of that. Without that, but it was transformational. The Civil Rights Act. I was there the night it passed the Senate in 1964.
You were there in the Senate.
I was, but
whoa.
In 1965, that's what laid down the predicate. It changed. It changed, Judy, that an African American family could go into a McDonald's, a father could go in with his children and buy a hot dog or a hamburger or whatever. Which it was federal law, you know, that there was discrimination in movie theaters and bus stations, in transportation. In hotels, motels. That changed. But 65 was the key. And that was the Voting Rights Act. Because that was power. That was actual power at the polling place. And to me, that was the key. But without 64, you'd never get to 65. And without either, you don't. Lyndon Johnson was central. He was dominant. Make no mistake about it. He was a man like all of us with faults. But he was a legislator. Slash executive, unmatched.
But 49 years later, we're still talking about voting rights. As Mark said, David, the law that passed the year after the civil rights.
Right.
What's the main unrealized promise of both of those pieces of legislation?
Well, it's the inequality of living conditions. That these many years after the Civil Rights Act, African Americans still have lower graduation, lower incomes. There's still inequalities. And not only inequalities of opportunity, but inequalities that are defined along racial lines. And so that's still a remaining challenge. And I would say that's more a challenge of economic opportunity and social policy, less of some of the legal stuff. But it remains the core stain on our society that the color of the skin is really either advantages you or disadvantages you in the course of your life.
I agree with what David said. I just add that Colin Powell put it very bluntly when he spoke in North Carolina to a group of businessmen after that state passed a very restrictive Voting Rights Act, a voter ID law. He said there is no voter fraud. There is none. And all of these voter ID laws that have been passed since the Supreme Court decision last year limiting the Voting Rights Act are intended for one purpose, and that's to suppress non-white voters. And that remains a part of unfinished business and in our politics.
Well, while we're talking about voting, and it's this year, of course, the midterm election, 2016, it's never too soon to talk about that. Two prominent maybe presidential candidates in the news this week, David, former Florida Governor Jeb Bush repeating his support for immigration reform and for the Common Core, which we just heard Jeff's conversation about. Conservatives have jumped on him. What does that mean? Do you think he's going to run? What's your thinking about Jeb Bush?
I personally don't think he's going to run. That's just a guess based on no knowledge, just simply because he has not shown the intense desire in the past. And I've never seen a candidate where that intense desire flowers in middle age. You're born with it or something. I think he's right on the merits on both subjects. And he's reminiscent of where his brother was, frankly, and where the Republican Party used to be not too long ago, in support of Common Core, which are high standards and much higher standards than the state standards, in support of a compassionate immigration policy. And so I think he's absolutely right on the merits. But where the Republican Party has shifted, it makes it much harder than it was when his brother ran.
There are two kinds of conservatives. There are 5 minutes to midnight conservatives, and there are 5 minutes to sunrise conservatives. 5 minutes to midnight conservatives, that things are bad, and they're going to get worse. 5 minutes to sunrise conservatives think, yeah, things are bad, but they're going to get better. And Jeb Bush is very much in the second category. And the Republican Party, especially the Congressional Party, is overloaded with 5 minutes to midnight conservatives. They're just hoping that Obamacare implodes. They're just hoping that things go wrong and get worse, that unemployment somehow rises. And I think in that sense, he brings something to the race that it desperately needs. I'd say there's one number you have to look at to decide whether he runs. He has approximately a 40-inch waist right now. If that goes down to 34 inches, I will say he's running.
Okay. Are we going to start using that as a measurement?
Then he'll be it's a 5 o'clock somewhere conservative.
That's right.
All right, very quickly, 45 seconds. Hillary Clinton, the other possible presidential candidate, had a shoe thrown at her, Mark, in Las Vegas yesterday. She ducked. What does this say about her character?
She handled it superbly. There are very few unscripted, spontaneous moments in politics. Yesterday was one of them in Las Vegas, and Hillary Clinton showed humor, she showed grace, and she showed a certain self-deprecating quality. I thought it was a 10 strike for her.
Yeah. Throw a flip-flop. Throw something challenging. Don't throw a big shoe. Or maybe a
cowboy
boot. It
looked like a heavy shoe.
I think you want to throw a flip-flop, just something symbolic, not to hurt anybody.
She asked if it was a bat or Cirque du Soleil. All right. You guys are both a Cirque du Soleil every week. David Brooks, Mark Shields, thank you.